How are you?
I'm okay. How are you? You have had actually a pretty remarkable career already. You're not 50 yet. Your birthday's for another year away, your big one.
Yeah. Yeah.
And yet you've had 15 years of pretty solid work in the industry at a very high level with very high-end directors or directors who became high-end with you working with them, interestingly enough. Were you always going to be a screenwriter? Was this something you know, mommy, I want to be a screenwriter when I grow up? Or
no, quite the opposite. You know, I'm the first person in my family to ever pursue a career in the arts. And when I went to college, I assumed I was going to pursue a career in psychiatry, which I don't know why. I didn't have any particular knowledge about what it entailed to be a psychiatrist, other than that my father's a pediatrician, my mother's a social worker, and just I just assumed I would go into medicine. I don't, again, like just without giving it too much thought. And my second year of college, I took an intro to film class. Mm. And I'd always been a film buff and a big reader. And I never really thought of film as something that was studied in an academic setting. And suddenly it just opened the world up to me. And I switched majors over to being a film and English major. And I was a student.
I'm sure your parents were thrilled by that.
Yeah, well, you know, it's funny. I'm the oldest of four, so they had other kids to think about at that point. So luckily they were distracted. And then by the time I graduated from Wesleyan, I said, you know, I'm going to pursue this. I thought probably I'd pursue being a writer-director. This is like 1993. Mm-hmm. I moved out to L.A., with my best friend from college, Dan Weiss, now known as D.B. Weiss from Game of Thrones, and the two of us moved out there together and found an apartment. Neither of us knew what the hell was going on. And I managed to get a job in a mailroom at Savoy Pictures, which doesn't exist anymore. But
I remember Savoy, though.
Yeah, they made Bronx Tale was their big breakout in Shadowlands. And while working there, I started writing screenplays. And really, my big break sort of came when I was ready to quit, and I had asked the woman, Stacey Adonazio, who was the vice president of production there, to read a script of mine. And she read it and said, "This is no way this is going to sell. It's just not, it's not on the level. But it might be something that's can, you know, open the door to meet a few agents." And so I met a few, and you know, started a relationship with one of them and just sent him my scripts over and over. Here's what I'm working on. Here's what I'm working on. And finally, by the time I was about 25, I was able to sell one to Warner Brothers. And,
were you bursting to tell stories, or were you kind of going along with the system, or
I
make movies?
I mean, I had, listen, I was coming at it as a fan of cinema, and was really, a lot of my early stuff especially was emulating things I was enamored with. So especially at the time, John Dahl's films were very popular. If you remember, like Last Seduction and Red Rock West.
John Dahl.
That script that I had given to Stacey was very much a knockoff of those kind of films. It was, you know, a neo-noir. And I was also a huge fan of 70s paranoid thrillers like Clute and Parallax View. And so the first spec I wrote was a story I've been sitting on for a while, which was a paranoid thriller that in the vein of like Manchurian Candidate. Never got made. Weirdly is very close to the movie Limitless that they finally did make, to the point where now I couldn't sell it even if I wanted to. Like it would feel like it steps on it, but I somehow got to that idea a little bit ahead of it.
You're stealing this.
Yeah. So I had a bunch of ideas. They weren't, you know, again, my life was, I was very fortunate. I didn't have any sort of traumas that defined me that I felt like I needed to sort of repurpose into fiction or anything. I was simply, a fan of really well-made films and a fan of great novels, and was just trying to do my best to emulate the experience of watching those when I sat down to create something.
So when you finally got one made, was that, I mean, there's a little one on your list.
Well, the little one, yes, that was that agent that I met finally said, "Oh, I can get you a job. I think it pays about $10,000 and you can rewrite this straight to video movie," which was a knockoff of Single White Female. It was a fun experience. I was, you know, it was fun to tell my parents I was getting paid to write. I was maybe 23 or 24 at the time, and that felt like a really big deal. And when I finally got a film made, it was a spec script I had written called Godsend, which, you know, made a little bit of a splash when it went out as a spec. And it was a cloning thriller, which felt a little bit ahead of its time. But I would be lying to you if I thought the film came out well. It didn't, for a whole bunch of reasons, and my fault is, you know, right up there.
Were you on it through the whole process, or were you?
I was. We could do a whole hour of just the Godsend experience. I was really, you know, I was very novice in many ways. It was the first produced feature, and I really wanted to please everybody. And so any note I got, I readily tried to, you know, execute, even if I wasn't sure it was the note that would make anything better or worse. And, you know, I don't want to slam other people working on it. It's just that everybody was a little bit out of their element working on that.
Right.
And I think it showed. But I learned.
Well, you also had the Greg Kinnear curse, which I think Greg Kinnear is a lovely guy and a nice actor and all that. But he really has had a hard time. Like,
it's funny because
taking off.
Autofocus, I thought, was quite a good film.
It is.
And I, you know, he probably had the Mark Bomback curse at that point. you know, he actually was such a sport and was really a trooper about it. And again, I was really green as a screenwriter. If I look at that script now, I'm sure I'd cringe. And you know, I think he went into it with expectations that it would be more elevated than it actually wound up being. And I felt certainly a tremendous amount of guilt that his name was associated with it. And anyway, it's in our rearview mirror, and it's
definitely a
film. And, you know, yeah.
Well, the next film, I'm not going to go to every film, but Live Free or Die Hard was one of those studio films with a lot of writers. And you got the credit.
That's a no. Yeah, it's funny. So that was one, they've been developing that for a while. And I had been doing some rewriting on a movie for Bruce Willis and his then partner, Arnold Rifkin, a Dean Pariseau movie that never got made, but it was a comedy, an action comedy. And Bruce and Arnold took a liking to me. And so he had had a meeting at Fox, and they said, "What do you, you know, you really want to resurrect Die Hard?" And he said, "Well, you're going to hire this young guy I've been working with on this other project." And they were like, "Oh, let's look at his credits. Oh, Godsend, it's a great fit." But I, you know, he has this line that was used many times over the course of production, which is, "Who's your second choice to play John McClane?" You know, so right. He had the power to say, "You're going to do it." And so they hired me, I think assuming that I would get kicked off after a draft and they were just going to humor Bruce and Arnold. And I knew this was my one shot to really try to crush it. And so I worked really, really hard on that script. And luckily managed to hang on to that project for a while, and Len came on, and Len and I forged a great relationship. And I think, you know, it's funny, you look back on it and it's like, oh, they make all these Die Hard movies. But at the time they hadn't made one for like 12 right. years. And I don't think people were assuming it was going to be either a financial or a critical success, but it wound up being both. And it really changed my career for the better. And I have only fond memories of it now, even though, of course, at the time there was all kinds of struggles, but it was beyond net positive for me.
So did you become typed as a guy who then took franchises? Because you had two or three other resurrected franchises.
That's the definition of a high class problem. I mean, yes, I was on the list now for franchise movies. You know, not everyone, but certainly if someone said, you know, a good example actually is the Wolverine movie I worked on, which again, I came into that through a relationship I already had with Jim Mangold. But I think Fox, especially because of Live Free or Die Hard, felt like, oh, he's someone that we can entrust sort of an existing franchise to. He's not going to try to blow it up or reinvent it. He's going to try to sort of honor it. And so that's, I think that reputation got around a little bit, which is why I got on those lists.
So do you like that reputation, the idea that you will make it work as opposed to break it and make it something new and sparkly? Or
I mean, I don't...
Because in some ways, the Wolverine does that, actually. The Wolverine really, you know, the next movie became the one that everybody talks about still, though I think the Wolverine's underrated in many ways and is a terrific movie. But, you know, that really was a franchise breaker. That changed what the idea of the franchise was.
So much of the credit of that for that goes to Jim Mangold, who, you know, so what happened was he came onto that movie. I think Chris McQuarrie had written a draft, and Jim said, I really think we could do something really unique here. Because it, in a way that the movie, the Wolverine movie before it had sort of disappointed some people. And so he had this opportunity to try to break the rules of it. And we both weren't, you know, hardcore X-Men fans that we were like going to be slavishly devoted to the canon. So we were able to say what would be the movie we'd be most excited to see if we were told, hey, there's a Wolverine movie. And we got really, you know, it was a very fun process. I've had this with a few directors where part of the process is watching a bunch of films and getting inspired. And I remember like 13 Assassins, right? The Takeshi Miike film. For some reason, we were both like, oh, we could do a 13 Assassins version of this, or Outlaw Josie Wales. And like, it was, you know, it was really, Jim's a great director to work with in that circumstance, because he is really striving to exceed what the expectations are. At the risk of sounding immodest, like I feel like with the Apes movies, they're anything but typical franchise movies. But you know, again, when I get hired to do, especially script doctoring, I do think I have a reputation of being someone who will try to improve upon what it is you're doing, but stay true to, you know, the tone of the thing. Now I should say, for that reason, I tend to turn down a lot of jobs because I don't think I can do a good job on it, because I don't necessarily feel like I can capture the voice of the franchise, whether it's because I'm not a big enough fan of the existing movies, or simply it's just out of my wheelhouse tonally.
So does that mean that you are less ambitious than one might expect from your success, or?
No, hopefully not. No, I think it's not that at all. I just feel like when someone's, look, there's two kinds of jobs that I do, right? They're the ones where I'm first guy in the door and I'm really sitting there and helping build a film. And those, I think I really try to be very, very ambitious about what I'm doing. And then there are others where I'm hired to be either a script doctor, where I know my name won't even appear on the screen, or I'm doing a rewrite that's really trying to just improve upon what it is people have been working on. And then in those instances, look, not every writer is interested in doing that kind of work. I feel like over time I've gotten my skills up to a point where I can apply them to these things. And so, you know, I get a big kick out of someone saying, we're struggling here. This is the movie we're trying to make. Can you help us get there? And, you know, I enjoy it. I enjoy making the people I'm working with feel like they got their money's worth for hiring me. And I enjoy seeing something get better under my watch. And so that's not about ambition.
When I said ambition, I didn't mean artistic ambition. I meant more like just career. There are definitely guys who, I was actually in that same position you were in at the very beginning of those first two films you did.
Yeah.
And I made a couple films for a terrible company in LA, and I got out because I could not deal with being the guy that, you know, got pushed aside, or the director had a different vision slightly, and all of a sudden they're rewriting stuff on the set and you're like, want to kill somebody. I could not deal with it. So I understand that weird, but I always think there are guys who, like you say, you know, are in these big movies and don't get credit, but they get paid, but they don't get credit. And it's like, to me, it would like your soul has to come out of your body.
You know, it's funny. One of my very, very closest friends in the business is Matt Reeves, who I co-wrote War for the Planet of the Apes with and directed, you know, both the films. And Matt is someone who will ask me that. He doesn't get it. He'll say to me, I don't understand how you could come in and not feel so 100% emotionally attached to it and feel the sense of ownership that I'd need to feel to do that kind of work. And, it's just how you're built in some ways. And again, like it's a lot of screenwriting, at least for the way I do it, I liken it a bit to being an architect. And sometimes you're building your dream house and it's a house maybe you yourself will want to live in. And other times someone's drawn up plans and for some reason the house isn't getting to the place where it wants to get. And I feel like you have a set of skills that you've amassed, and it's fun to collaborate with someone where you don't have, I can't do a job if I don't connect to it. Right. So I'll turn down rewrites all the time to say, like, I'm not your guy. I know what I'm capable of doing, and I can't fall in love with this project to even in this temporary way, to the extent I need to do a good job for you. But there are other times where I can say, I'm not marrying this woman. I'm just going to date her for a week or two. And I can, you know, it's a bizarre analogy, but it's true. You have to trick yourself into falling in love with it to the extent that you can do a really good job for the people working on it. But you also have to have a certain amount of emotional attachment, or you will experience this real disappointment and frustration that you're not either getting the credit for the work you did or you're not being heard in the way you'd want to be heard. And, you know, on the flip side, when I'm the first writer in the door, I especially, let me turn the setting off. I forgot to turn this. This is new to me, this stuff. So to turn the do not disturb button, you don't get a ding on text messages. When I'm first writer in the door, over time, especially, I really learned to be not defensive, but certainly very protective of the stuff that I know is going to work. And really gotten better at advocating for myself and saying to the people I'm working with, I get why it is you're reacting to this idea in here. Let me tell you where I'm coming from. Let's get to a place where, as the author of the screenplay, I feel satisfied, but also as the producer, as a director, whatever your role is, you also feel like you're being heard. It's a collaborative medium, you know, so that's part of it as well.
Well, it's sane. And I do think that certainly in recent decades, you've had people, writers, screenwriters who are going to be successful kind of have to take that approach. You know, you have to have enough of that, or even like the, you know, your friend from college who ended up doing Game of Thrones, his partner in that, you know, had a very high end perception, but didn't really get projects going. And then the right thing happened and all of a sudden, you know, he's got again, but it's like, he spent years not doing projects because his soul was too connected to them.
Yeah, I mean, it's a dance you do. And again, like, it's funny because this is also a bit of a strained analogy, but it's not totally unlike being a professional athlete where you finally made it to the majors, right? And like, but there are seasons and not every season is going to be a winning season. You have to sort of do your best at every at-bat and then you just hope collectively you've done justice to the, you know, the work that you've been trying to do. And sometimes those collaborations will, this is the end of that metaphor, but those collaborations will end in frustration because you say, oh, you know, this isn't what I set out to write, you know. But In a sense, it's not that you have to just have so much quantity of output, but I do think the more often you do it, the more you realize that all you can do is your best and all you can do is really protect the ideas that you feel passionately are in the interest of the project. And I think the trick over time, especially for me, is to be able to distinguish between what's my ego here and what is actually the work, you know? And if it's my ego because I thought this line was so clever, but someone's knocking it out, or this idea was so clever, or in the grander scheme of things, someone's saying this isn't as good as I thought it would be, you know? To what extent am I really the best judge of my own work? And that's sometimes I am and sometimes I'm not. So it's a long haul. And I think my craft has improved over the years, but I also think my confidence has improved over the years. And I feel my ability to advocate for myself has improved over the years. And the people I work with, I think, appreciate when I'm advocating for myself when they feel it's in the service of making the film better.
And you've been in good company. So that says good things for you as well.
Yeah, the people I work with tend to want to work with me again. So I guess.
Yeah. And Matt is one of the most beloved people in town.
He is right now. But, you know. Yeah. I mean, I've had some great collaborations with directors, but nothing on the scale of what Matt and I did over those two movies. And
you guys had a big canvas to work with, which is, I guess, kind of nice. You know, yeah. You guys, there really was an evolution from one film to, you know, even from the first film to the second, to the third, it changed.
We would pinch ourselves sometimes that we couldn't believe they were letting us make these kinds of movies, you know, because the influences were so disconnected from what you think of when you think of, you know, big franchise movies. Like for War for the Planet of the Apes, we spent like 2 weeks just watching epics, whether they were Westerns or biblical epics or Sword and Sandals, and just figuring out like, what is our version of this kind of film? And the reason we're able to do it is because it had apes in it, right? If we did the same story with humans, someone would have said, this is not the most commercial take in the world, but because our big effect in a way was having, you know, apes that are emotionally relatable and also in some ways more human than the humans in the story. And that's the big twist in our, it was the biggest blessing of my career in many ways because it is really exciting to work on a canvas that wide and to be, and then to have a collaborator like Matt, who is so passionate about his vision, you know, that there's tons of compromises you make along the way to make a film, But the one thing he is incapable of doing is compromising his vision for it, you know. And in a sense, as the screenwriter, as his co-writer, you're in a very protected place because you never worry that the director isn't sure of what it is he's pursuing, you know. So it was just incredibly fruitful and lovely collaboration. And
well, with both Jim and Matt, you have directors who have figured out to stick with the characters and then all the other stuff that goes on around it, whether they're vampires or apes or whatever, is kind of a secondary issue. I mean, it's kind of the 70s model with bigger effects.
What I marvel at with both of those guys is that they do that, right? They could make that sort of classic 70s film that you're referring to, but they're like multilingual because they can also speak the language of special effects and speak the language of stunts. And like, this is the thing that I marvel at. I'll see Matt in conversation with the guys from Weta, and he sounds just as fluid in that conversation as he does when he's talking about, you know, the scene from Spartacus that we're trying to emulate in this. So he and Jim both, they're really remarkably multifaceted. And I think that's part of the secret, is that they are coming from a place purely of character and story-driven, or character-driven story, but they also are able to really push the boundaries of what these other aspects of filmmaking are about. Yeah. I think it's what separates them from a lot of their peers.
Well, it's funny with the idea that Jim is going to jump into Indiana Jones. You know, it's like 10 years ago, you would never have imagined that. Now it's like, oh yeah, that actually kind of makes sense.
Yeah, you're excited for it because you're like, oh. Yeah. I know that he's going to bring a certain intelligence and a certain thoughtfulness to the project that, you know, not everyone does when they get handed the fifth film in a franchise or something.
Yeah. Or that Steven did when he had the fourth. Yeah. I don't think it was the script. I don't think it was the script so much in that movie as it was the amount of effects, because he kind of wanted, I thought the script was fine, but that the actual effects were so CG'd at that moment that it took away from what Indiana Jones was that we loved about it, which was that it was so intimate. You know,
it's hard to say, I had to criticize it. I think I saw it once along when it came out.
It still hurts my soul.
No, I think, you know, it's funny, even if you look at the effects from Rise of the Planet of the Apes to War for the Planet of the Apes, you see how just we're living in this time where the technology just is improving at this exponential rate. And so I wonder, actually, even the Apes films, they seem so photorealistic and incredible. And I wonder if 20 years from now, we're going to look at them and find things in them that feel funky that don't, you know, jump out to us now.
It's kind of amazing to watch Andy Serkis kind of take over that area and like become his own creator, not just a performer. It's been fascinating to watch.
He is the best.
Yes. And very passionate about the whole thing. I mean, he's not like Fran and Peter are really kind of invested in him with the Rings movies. And so, you know, he became this greater than just an actor, really, which is unusual. So defending your Jacob, Baker. Young Jacob, yes. I know, like, I can remember the name of the show eventually. defending Captain America. No, the wrong show. You actually do have a couple films on your resume that are in that vein. Yep. So you're more famous for the ones that are not. Nobody's exploding in this one. Nobody's wearing a digital mask.
Yeah.
Where did this all come from for you?
You know, it was sent to me, the book was sent to me by Anonymous Content as a film project. Steve Clovis had been developing it at Warner Brothers as a film. For whatever reason, it didn't get to the finish line. The option had expired. And so Anonymous sent me the book and said, this has come up. Any chance you want to set this up at a studio somewhere? And I started reading it, and it immediately became clear to me, I see what happens with Steve Clovis's approach. Like, it's just not the kind of book that becomes a movie these days. You know, it's certainly not a multiplex, you know? And so I started almost checking out, you know, and just reading it for pleasure at a certain point, because, well, this is just probably not for me, but I couldn't put it down. And about halfway through, it occurred to me, wait, there's another way to go with this, which is I do think it would really be in the spirit of the stuff I'd admired recently, like Broadchurch and True Detective and The Night Of. And I said, oh, maybe there's an approach like that with this story. And there's something about it, right? I think you could have given it to 50 screenwriters and they would have said, oh, there's a limited series here. Here's how you do it, right? But there was something about it that really spoke to me personally, in that it's set in suburbia that's the suburbia of Boston. But where I live in Westchester County is not dissimilar to it at all. It's probably the entire country. I couldn't find another place that's more reminiscent of where I live. And it's about parenthood and the sort of the anxiety that comes with loving your child more than you love yourself, right? And this feeling of being almost a prisoner of that unconditional love. And I have four kids, and I will say, maybe to an almost unhealthy degree, I am very preoccupied with my role as a father. You know, I work at home, I see them all the time, I'm very involved in their lives, sometimes maybe too much involved in their lives.
Even before the pandemic.
Oh, now it's reached a level. Weirdly, I'm probably less involved now because I see them so frequently that I try to hide in my office. When I go inside, it's like emotional Russian roulette. Like someone is about, I have four different age groups in there. Someone's going to blow at any given moment.
That's a movie. I want to see that movie.
It's a very, very, very dark comedy. I said to myself, well, a limited series is something I think you're going to really spend an inordinate amount of time working on. So I'd also really need to care about the subject matter. And so, you know, I've had false alarms or little scares with my kids throughout the years, and magnifying that to something on this scale just seemed really like I just knew I could think about it over and over and never get tired of that dilemma. And so I felt like I'm going to bring something to this. I feel like it's a world I really have a knowledge of, maybe more so than the average person. And it's a topic that I really care deeply about. And I, especially a father-son relationship, is something that I would love to spend a lot of time working on. And, you know, it's not that you can't do it in genre, and certainly you can do it in even the biggest blockbuster, but there's also these other mandates that I knew that I wouldn't have to think about with this. And it could really, because of the nature of the format and just how expansive it is, it wants you to think about these things a lot. Like you'd almost not be doing your job if you didn't spend a lot of time diving deep on these character issues. So that was the challenge, and that to me was what I was most excited about.
So which came first, the format or the egg? I mean, do you, when you are developing it, are you going, okay, this is 6 hours, or this is 8 hours, or this is 2 hours? Or do you wait till you get to Apple and then go, this is an opportunity to do as much as I need to do?
The answer was, I came into Apple with so Paramount and Anonymous controlled the book at that point, and they said, well, you know, we'll hire you to write a pilot and come up with an outline. Mm-hmm. So I wrote the pilot and came up with an outline that I sort of decided on 8. I think Steve Golan at the time said, we like 8. We like even numbers, try to do it at 8. So I tried 8.
We like even numbers.
And it felt right, but I didn't know. I'd never done it before. And when I pitched Apple, you know, I was very clear. I said, I think it's 8, but I might start working on this and think it's 9. It might be 6. It might be 7. I don't know. And as luck would have it, 8 felt like when I got to the end of the pilot script, and it was around 55, 60 pages, and I said, okay, I can sort of start to pace out how this is going to feel as I'm writing it. It does feel like 8's the right number. And, you know, if at some point I had gotten to the place where it really did feel like we had run out of highway, or I couldn't finish in time, I know Apple would have given me the leeway to add or subtract an episode, but it turned out to be 8.
Well, I guess that's part of the question. I mean, is working, I mean, Apple may or may not be a unique circumstance right now because there are so many streamers in the game, obviously, sure, or coming into the game. But I mean, is there that kind of feeling, like as a writer, as a creator, that there's a kind of a wider expanse of opportunity to do it as you see appropriate?
I can't speak for everyone else's experiences at their streamers where they work. I will say I've never had the creative freedom. Now, I should say I've also never been the showrunner and the executive producer of a project where, you know, if I wasn't, I'd probably have to answer to that person and then have less freedom. But because I was in that role and also writing all the episodes, I've never experienced that much freedom, like where I turned in a script and the notes would be, first, if there was a note I disagree with, they would say, well, you don't have to do it, but this is our thought. And if there's a note I agreed with, they were usually just really in the service of trying to make the show a little better, and really questioning things that I hadn't thought about hard enough. And so this sounds like the cliched sort of EPK answer, was it a great experience? Oh, they were the best. But it really was a very positive experience. They interfered almost not at all on the creative front. And, you know, any questions they had. Again, I didn't, on the movie side, sometimes you'll get a note, right? And you know this, the note underneath the note is, this is too expensive an idea, or this is too risque, or this is gonna isolate this segment of the audience, but they'll pretend it's creative, right? They'll say, we want, in this case, I can't think of a note that came in that really was in anything other than, I think the story would be a little more comprehensible if you did this, or I think we'd like this character a little more if you tried this. And by like, I don't even mean make more sympathetic, but literally like care about more. So it was a great, when I compare it to a lot of my experiences as a screenwriter for hire, especially, it was a lot more rewarding.
What's interesting is that your show is so completely not episodic. You know, you really can't come in episode 4 and go, okay, let's just go.
No, it's not. I mean, it's funny. I had to do the, I had the task of with the editors, you know, trying to come up with the previously on, and it's not my forte. And, you know, but also it's like, I don't know, I guess you'd have to just watch these other episodes to figure out what's going to try to me, they were functioning more as like jogging your memory. Hey, remember when this happened 3 episodes ago, this is going to be important to when you watch it now. No, I mean, in many ways, it was like making an 8-hour movie. The only difference really is that I did try to structure it that by the time you reach the end of each episode, there was something approaching a cliffhanger sensation, or at least something that makes you want to sort of see what happens next. Right. And it's really had to do more with when I decided that's the end of the episode, you know, but not so much in terms of the structure. But if you look at the macro structure, it basically has a 3-act structure.
Yeah.
Like movie would.
Yeah, no, it's a fascinating time because with all the transition we're going through, I've been, particularly with documentaries, I think lately, watching kind of this expansion that's happening to people's work because the opportunity is there, which has never been there before. You know, you can't make an 8-hour movie generally.
Yeah.
unless you're making a movie about apes or rings. you don't really have that opportunity. So but watching, it's like, you're kind of like now seeing the expansion, maybe they're going too far with some things, and maybe they're not enough. And it's like, there's this dance, but it's a fascinating time and times of the work. In terms of the work,
I mean, it's such a privilege to get that amount of storytelling time. And you know, some people might watch it and say that we're going too slow, or some people might watch it and say we went in an avenue that they wouldn't have gone. That's their taste and that's their prerogative, and I certainly can't argue with it. But I will say, like, again, like, to me, it's exactly what I was trying to make, which is something that is functioning like a page-turning thriller, but also functioning like a drama, and sort of doing both. And I think the condensed running time version of this, one of the two of those would have suffered, and it would have been the drama. And so it's, you know, and again, like, not every book can sustain it, and you know, or every story idea can sustain it. This one felt to me like it could, and that's why I pursued it. And so I don't look back and say, ooh, the movie version, I wonder what that, I just wouldn't have been as interested in the movie version.
Right. And am I correct in remembering that there was kind of a passing reference to Serial or something like Serial in the first episode?
There's a reference of, yeah, popular podcasts. And yeah, I mean, I'm a huge fan of those true crime podcasts. And I felt like this was the kind of thing that if this had happened in real life, someone would have made a podcast about this case.
So that did not become part of the show, really.
Not to the extent that I wanted to sort of insert it as a through line and sort of, to me, really what I was trying to do with the writing of the show and the storytelling was you're getting increasingly more and more interior and claustrophobic with this family. So leaving them, you really need to have a good reason to leave them. And you're just really starting to feel the walls closing in. Somehow having the editorializing of a podcast at the same time would have maybe felt sort of robbed that sensation.
Yeah.
But I did like the idea that someone had made one. And that's referenced at some point.
Well, weirdly, Apple TV Plus has another show that is about
that's
that.
That's true.
So,
but it's about a podcaster. So yeah, I mean, it makes more sense if it's about a podcaster for sure. Yeah.
You could do a whole nother season.
Yes, we could just reverse engineer the storytelling once more.
Some of those shows, particularly the British shows where they really don't do second seasons or worry about that stuff, I'm like, really? Yeah. They're going to do another season? They were done. Brilliantly so, but they were done after one. I don't need to see another one.
Yeah. Well, also, you know, a show that's really interesting is Broadchurch, right? Because I think the first season of Broadchurch is just impeccable. It's just beautifully, beautifully done. And it creates these two, this beyond just being a fantastic, you know, example of storytelling, this relationship that gets forged. And then at the end of it, it's put to this incredible test, you know. And then season two, for my taste, wasn't as successful as season one, except that I still loved watching it because they had built these two characters. And then what was interesting with season three is you realize we need to just move away from that world and get these two characters. And it's an interesting thing in that it's not the X-Files, you know, it's not like right. this partnership and putting them in the case of a week. It's this partnership in the case of the season, which is I don't know if they're making any more or not, but it was a really interesting thing, which again, I think we're living in this great age where there's this hybrid of what's a limited series, what's an actual series. You know, the notion of a movie of the week, or you know, these things are just, we're in this really flux time, which, you know, again, I think it'll be interesting to look back on this now and say, where do we get it right? Where do we get it wrong in the storytelling of it all?
Well, there are a lot of shows where that first season is brilliant, and then that second season, you're like, they really should have just left it. And then the third season, they figure out to go in a different direction, like you were saying, and it takes off again because it's a different show completely.
Yeah.
And it's kind of fascinating. There are a few shows. There's a show on Netflix. Let's promote Netflix on Apple TV Plus's podcast. there was a show called Marcella. That's a British show. That's the first season is breathtaking. And it kind of comes to the end that it should have come to. And then the second season, as I say, you love the cast, you're invested in the relationships, you want to see, you still like them, but it's not, the tension has changed because there's no longer that kind of one question in the air that's going to be answered by the end. And
yeah.
It's just the whole, the dramatic purpose of it is gone.
And you start to become, I haven't seen Marcella, although I've heard it's great, but you start to become a little bit aware that someone is writing this, that it's being made, you know, that the writer of this is aware that they made a season of television that was really successful and now they need to somehow, you know, keep it on life support. And, you know, it's an interesting challenge for people. Like, I don't know what Damon Lindelof's plans are with Watchmen, but it's interesting that he's been very, you know, hands-off about, like, I'm not going to weigh in whether or not this was a one-off or not.
Yeah, the same thing on Leftovers, in a way. When Leftovers happened, people, like, were kind of gone. And then all of a sudden, when it came back for the third season, people were in loved it with such an, like, that was their favorite thing.
Yeah.
It was better than the first thing. It was better than, you know, like, the passion was there. They figured it out. But sometimes it takes 2 years to figure it out.
Yeah, for sure.
You're like, what the hell? But it's also kind of beautiful that writers are having the chance to do that.
Yeah. So, I mean, again, it's a great time to be a writer. It's not the greatest time in the world to be a writer for big studio movies, right? I think that the opportunities there are shrinking. I do think there's a lot of risk aversion that, you know, goes into those decisions. It doesn't mean you can't make movies that are great within the system. It's just a little bit harder and the opportunities are fewer. But it is a great time to write in the moving image format. And it's, again, like that with Defending Jacob, I would just stand there on set sometimes and just marvel at the fact that we were allowed to do this, you know, that it just, the movie version would have had a very capped budget and there would have been a lot of mandates about like what it needs to be and not be. And it would in some ways try to be very formulaic because it didn't have a choice otherwise, or else it wouldn't have gotten even greenlit, you know? And
the casting also is like, definitely,
yeah, I mean,
Chris is great, but he's not necessarily the guy you would go, let's do a series with a, you know, dramatic male center around, even though he's a good actor. It's not, you know, that's not necessarily the casting choice ABC would have made, or whomever. And she is terrific, but she's not necessarily the choice you would have made. The same with the kid. I mean, there doesn't seem to be that need to bend over for the system.
Yeah, I mean, again, it's why it's also a great time for actors. You know, I just think again, like Chris, you know, is very, very, very thoughtful about what he decides to work on. And I think with this, he really kicked the tires very carefully because he did know this was an opportunity to do something that on the movie side would have been a bigger challenge, you know? And I think like myself, he oftentimes would just sit there grinning on set, being like, I can't believe we're making this. We spent the whole day just filming this argument between these two parents in their living room, you know. It's a treat to do that. It's a privilege to do that. And especially, we had a very healthy budget to do it. And, you know, we never felt like we were just jamming these things through. I mean, it was a very packed schedule, and I would say we used every penny we were given and wish we had more, but it's especially coming from Chris, coming from Avengers, me coming from Apes and things like that. There's something just incredibly fortunate feeling about standing there and working on something that more often than not was a drama, you know?
Yeah. We shouldn't tell people about the Chris Hemsworth, Scarlett Johansson showing up in the third episode. That's like,
spoiler.
Don't tell anyone.
Exactly.
And I don't want to do any spoilers, but I wonder how your wife feels about the series.
Well, it's interesting. You know, my wife had never read the book, although a lot of her friends had. So her experience with the show was through reading. She's always my first reader, so she read the scripts as I was writing them. And I think she's seen every episode except for 8. I think I actually said to her, hang on and watch 8. Well, there's parts of 8 where I showed her pieces on my, you know, on my pick system, but never start to finish. So I'll be curious to hear if she has any reactions to the arc of this couple's journey.
And you have a bunch of projects already in the pipeline, right, at this point after this?
I have some, yeah. I mean, again, it's hard to tell what ultimately has a chance of getting made or not. Some I'm excited about, some are in their very, you know, infancy stage, and some are in film, and I definitely would love to find something else in television. I don't have the thing in television next that's on this this scale. So I'm trying to figure out what that could be. As I say to people when I talk about it now, it's like, this was a lot of work. And I'm not saying poor me. It was pleasurable and very lucky work to have. But it was really almost 3 years of my life, start to finish, to do it. And you have to love it. And you have to feel like no matter what happens, this was worth it. You know, I learned a lot as a writer. I learned a ton as a producer. But most of the time when I had a bad day, I had to remind myself, we're making something that you're really excited to make. And so I have to have that same bar for whatever it is that I work on next on the scale.
So you're not a given. It's not a given that you'll be a showrunner for the next, you know, you're not anxious to get back in the saddle, or you're willing, but not
back in the saddle. For sure. I'm anxious to get back in the saddle with the right material. But I wouldn't be a showrunner for hire or sort of jump into something unless I really felt confident. You know, I know the sensation I had when I set up Defending Jacob, that like, again, this sounds a little immodest, but sitting there, I'm like, I am the perfect person to write this for you. Like, you're getting the right person when you hire me for this particular project. And I felt like a really good partner to Apple in saying to them, like, trust me, I'm going to give you a show you'll be proud of. So I need to have that same feeling, or else I would feel like I'm being a phony, and I can't sleep at night feeling like I BS'd my way into a job that now I'm going to live with for 3 years and maybe don't love as much as I should.
Well, in many ways, as a showrunner, though, you're taking on not only the writer's job, but you're also taking on part of the director's job in terms of the vision for the overall project and maintaining that
through the whole process. No. Yeah, I mean, you know, the truth is, I think
the film director's job.
Yeah, it's probably project dependent. I mean, Morton is clearly a film director, but he's also worked in television,
that's
so
true.
He understood that dynamic is different on a set. We had some very frank conversations early on where, you know, I made it clear I'm willing to sort of give up some of that quote unquote power that a showrunner is supposed to have, and you're gonna, you know, of course, need to give up a lot of the autonomy that a director has. And the only way we got through it is we just were very, if we weren't on the same page, we got on the same page really quickly. And we were very lucky in that 99 times out of 100, we saw the exact same thing. So there was never a worry that we were rowing in opposite directions. And he's also an EP on it. So in many ways, he was an ally where I was having struggles in that producer role. I would recruit Morton into a conversation with the studio or with the network and say, you know, here's the struggles for next week's work. We're, you know, here's the production issues. How are we going to solve this? And again, it was a big learning curve for me. It was a learning curve a bit for Morton as well, because while he's done a pilot for a couple of shows, he never directed 8 hours of television. So we both learned on the job. And again, he was a very, very willing collaborator and not looking to sort of hijack the show and turn it into a movie set. And, you know, I was very grateful for that.
Together, the first cut of the space movie was 8 hours. So, and does he still feel like a kid? I mean, the funny thing, obviously, he's brilliant and enormously capable, but he's very young when he got going at such a high level.
I guess so. I'll take that as a compliment because I think he's a year or two older than I am. But, you know, he's, yeah, he's like, he's right around my age. I think he's a little older than I am. He looks younger than I didn't age well, so I look like I'm much older than I am. He's got that Norwegian genetics where he's got this very full head of blonde hair and a nice 6'2" frame. And believe me, standing next to him on set every day for 14 hours was not the, you know, the most ego sustaining sensation.
And you, it seems like you have fulfilled your promise as both a therapist and a writer.
In some ways, that I will say very much that role as an EP, you do wind up feeling a bit like a therapist, and that you have a lot of people coming to you with different problems, and you do sort of talk through the different issues and try to get them to feel. But I'm guessing what your question really meant is the show itself is a bit of a psychological exercise.
No, I actually mean you. You actually seem sane. Yes. I know very few screenwriters who seem as sane as you do. I'm guessing you don't have a bottle behind your printer there.
No, although
which you know, you're not smoking endlessly. So
I will say the alcohol consumption during lockdown has definitely increased. But no, I don't have a bottle by my side. No, you know, here's the thing: is that I take it's my job. It's, you know, it's my craft, and it's to an extent my art, but it's also my job. And I do have 4 kids, and I try to live a life where I take my work very seriously and consider myself professional. And again, I work with people who, you know, it's not a medium that is a cheap thing to produce the finished product. Like, it's people trust you with a lot of money, and they expect you to really do your best and work your hardest. And so I take it very seriously and feel very lucky that I've had a career that's gotten me to this place, and never take it for granted.
I'm guessing you would expect the same of yourself, even without them poking at you.
Yes. I was raised by people who work that way. And, you know, I have 3 brothers who all are professionals, not in the industry, and who work that way. And I will say it's the thing that frustrates me most is when I encounter someone in our business who thinks that because it's the arts, it's a license to not work very hard. You know, I don't encounter many, but there are some, you know, and it's if you're lucky enough to, again, to sort of circle back to that ridiculous analogy, but if you're lucky enough to play in the majors, you should really be grateful for it. And again, your season, you're not going to be a pro athlete forever. You know, someone's coming up behind you. And so I think you really need to be grateful for it and take the work really seriously, which is what I try to do.
I think that's one of the probably the main thing that people outside of the industry don't understand in all areas is that it is work. fun as it is, as much glamour, as much money, whatever else, that ultimately the job is the job, and that people, you know, the way somebody takes pride in making the best meal, a chef makes the best meal at a restaurant, a screenwriter or an actor or a grip takes pride in doing their job. You know,
I still have that sensation sometimes if I meet with someone who I've idolized, whether it's an actor or a director, or if I'm working in an editing room with a director, and it's oftentimes so unglamorous and so mundane, and it's work, and you're just sitting there trying to figure stuff out. And I always say, gee, this is what it's like. I didn't realize, you know, when I was fantasizing about what it means to be a professional at this level, it just had a sense of glamour to it that doesn't actually exist when you're here behind the lines. Just everyone is working really hard, and really oftentimes it's admitting they don't really know how to do it, you know, and we're figuring out as we go sometimes. And in some ways it's very refreshing that you built these things up to be something that feel like they're just fun and games, and it's really hard work. And and for that sometimes you know I'm most grateful, because I don't feel like I'm getting over on the world. I'm working quite hard to do it, you know.
Yeah, I always think they should like find a way to glamorize up the cutting rooms. Because editors always seem to be in the basement of the shittiest, building anywhere, in a cement block room in the dark. And then you go to the post house to do the sound, and it's beautiful, and the couches are great, and they bring you lattes constantly. And, you know, meanwhile, these guys are hidden away in the basement.
these huge decisions that have been made on films that you worship are made in these little shoebox rooms with no light.
The biggest decisions, the most critical moments are taking place in the worst rooms in the world.
It's amazing. I think about that a lot too. Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah. Well, you have a lovely room. And I feel like we're now seeing everybody's homes. It's kind of
That's a fun part about it. I know. I've had to think about this because I do work from New York, so I've done video meetings a lot with my colleagues. So I've thought about, you know, what this angle is, but it also is functional because it is my office. So it serves its dual role. Usually I have a lot of 3x5 index cards behind me, which is how I sort of get my thoughts together. But I've had to take them down for
we would know too much.
Yeah, or just a distraction. You're going to try to sort of discern what it is that's written back there.
Yeah, we went to Aaron Sorkin's office once for a shoot, and he refused to sit at his desk because he had so many Emmys behind his desk that he thought it was embarrassing.
Yeah, all my awards are tucked in my closet. I did the same thing. Just kidding, of course. No.
Thank you so much for your time. Appreciate it. And for the work on the show as well. I guess you're premiering in a couple days, right? On Friday?
We premiered on Friday. And then our next episode is this Friday.
There is so much television now.
I don't follow.
That I can't keep up with when things start. I mean, my favorite shows. It'll pop up on my TV. Oh, you have an episode of whatever. And I'm like, not aired already?
There is so much content. My brother just alerted me to there's an author we both love, Chuck Klosterman. And my brother just alerted me to a podcast he's had on for 2 months about rock music, which is like the subject. I mean, if you had told me Chuck Klosterman, I am so the target audience. Somehow that information didn't reach me. And it's really because there's so much stuff out there all the time. Thank God I found it. But it's amazing that there's just never ending options for entertaining yourself.
Even doing what I do, I think, oh, well, we're going to have this moment. Everybody's stuck at home. We can come do shows. But now, you know, people can go on Letterman, or not Letterman, they can go on Kimmel and Fallon and whatever from their homes, sitting in front of their desk like you're doing. And that's considered high art now. Or do a Sondheim show or do whatever. It's kind of amazing.
It is amazing.
So, it screws me over, but that's okay. I can.
Well, you'll see. Maybe it'll work out in the long run.
Thank you again so much. And
David, it's a pleasure meeting you. Take good
care of all of your family.
Thank you. Thank you. Likewise.
With four kids, you have sequels, I think. That's like a
Let's hope not. For this show, let's hope not.
Refuting Joe or whatever it's called. Okay. Thanks so much. Take care.
Bye.